हेलो हेलो सुप्रिया हेलो ओके
यस सर
नाउ दिस नेजल पॉलीपोसिस मे बी अ कॉम्प्लिकेशन ऑफ योर क्रॉनिक राइनोसाइनसाइटिस सो विल सी नेजल पॉलीपोसिस अंडर सर्टेन हेडिंग्स लाइक योर इटियोलॉजी योर पैथोजेनेसिस Complications of nasal polyposis, differential diagnosis, and what are the different types of your polyps. And most important is your clinical feature, investigations, and treatment. Now, coming to the basic idea of the polyp, it is hypertrophied pale edematous mucosa. Arising from the nasal cavity or from the sinuses. Mostly it arises from the sinuses and comes back into the nasal cavity through the different orifices of the opening of the sinuses. The name polypus means many-footed because it has different attachments there in the sinus mucosa. The earliest record of the nasal polyp was recorded there in the literature approximately 2000 years BC. So it is recorded there in the history also, but at that time it was not so much diagnosed because of lack of investigations and other thing. It is seen that approximately in cadaver studies, 40% of the cadavers found to have this polyp in their sinuses or in the nasal cavity, 40%. But actually, in present scenario, it is only diagnosed as only 1 to 4% of population develops this nasal polyps are diagnosed. And rest, your 36% of the nasal polyps remain undiagnosed. Because of if you don't do investigations, if you don't go for the consultation with the doctors, so this may remain your undiagnosed. Now coming to the sex differentiation, it is seen mostly in male than female, and it is also found that in literature that this is very much weakly related to your allergic rhinitis. Nasal polyposis occurs with high frequency of the patient having severe airway diseases like your bronchial asthma, bronchiectasis. In those patients, the nasal polyposis is mostly seen. Now, regarding your studies have suggested that 14% of the patient with nasal polyps may run in the family. So in the family, if somebody is having polyp, their child or the offsprings may develop polyposis in 14% of the cases. You have two varieties of polyps. One is your ethmoidal, where the etiology is allergic, and other is the antrogonal polyp. The name suggests antrogonal means it arises from the antrum of the maxillary sinus and it moves towards the corona. And there are some other non-allergic conditions like your vasomotor imbalance, where sympathetic and parasympathetic or mismatch occurs and leads to your rhinitis, leading to your polyp formation. Now, one most important is your Bernoulli's phenomena. What is Bernoulli's phenomena? You know, this is your when the air is passed through a narrow passage. So during the passage of the air, the surrounding structure or the surrounding structures mean in this case, it is the mucosa of the nasal cavity or the paranasal sinuses. The and surrounding mucosa falls back into the stream, and due to constant pulling of that mucosa may lead to formation of your polyp. So this is Bernoulli's phenomena. You have important aspect in the etiology is your Samter's triad. What is Samter's triad? This triad comprises of your nasal polyposis. The patient may have asthma. Side by side, patient will have aspirin intolerance. Now, this aspirin intolerance in polyp patient or chronic rhinosinusitis is much higher. That is around 10 to 15% of patient of nasal chronic rhinosinusitis may have this type of aspirin intolerance. So, aspirin intolerance means this patient when nasal polyp patient having asthma, having aspirin intolerance. So you have to find out the patient having aspirin intolerance, because if in such patient, if you do surgery, then you will end up in difficulties. So you have to find out who are the right candidates for your surgery in nasal polyposis. Now there is one more syndrome which is called Kartner-Nagar syndrome. Kartner-Nagar syndrome is there is bronchiectasis, there will be sinusitis, situs inversus, ciliary dyskinesia. Young syndrome, where you have sinopulmonary disease as azoospermia. Cystic fibrosis, this is also a very difficult, challenging area where the patient having abnormal composition of mucus because of the lack of ciliary beat in the respiratory epithelium of the nose and paranasal sinus mucosa. So what happens? You know the normal respiratory epithelium is ciliated, pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium. So the cilia are lost in the cystic fibrosis, resulting in the mucus and the sole layer and the gel layer of the nasal mucosa becomes stagnant there, and it becomes very much thick. So in those patients also you will find difficulties in treating this type of patient. Now, what is the pathogenesis of polyposis? You will have either infection or you have the allergy in those patients may lead to gives right to some certain inflammatory conditions leading to your inflammatory cells like your leukotrienes, then your chemotactic factors, those may give rise to the vasodilatation of the vessels in the nasal mucosa or paranasal sinus mucosa and leading to your edema. This edema, when it become very much exaggerated, leading to your prolapse of the mucosa. Now this prolapse of the mucosa gradually grows due to Bernoulli's phenomena and leading to formation of your polyp. Now, what will happen if you don't treat those nasal polyp? The patient will have chronic sinusitis. There will be epistaxis. There will be changes in the respiratory epithelium of nasal mucosa. There will be mucosal or pyosal formation. The polyp may deviate the septum toward the opposite side. There is broadening of the nasal bridge, etc. So these are the complications of nasal polyp. Now you have to differentiate between a polyp and a hypertrophic turbinate. Most of the time, patients come to us with saying that I am having nasal blockage and there is something growing there. Is it a polyp? So you have to differentiate the other conditions from the nasal polyp, like your hypertrophic turbinate, rhinosporidiosis, inverted papilloma, malignancy, angiofibroma, rhinoscleroma, rhinolith, and other nasal midline granulomas. The most important is your hypertrophic turbinate. How will you differentiate this hypertrophic turbinate from the nasal polyp? The polyps are actually, if you go by the color, it is pale in color. whereas hypertrophic turbinate will be your reddish in color. If it is congested, it is reddish. And the hypertrophic turbinate on palpation, you will find that it is painful. It is painful, and please mute yourself. So the turbinates are painful, and when you do the probe test, you'll find that the probe is passed all around the polyp, whereas in case of hypertrophy turbinate, you will be stuck to the lateral wall. So the hypertrophy turbinate can be easily differentiated between the polyp from the polyp. Now coming to the, this is a picture where you find that endoscopy has been done, and this is the septum. It is deviated to the opposite side, and this is the medial turbinate. You see, this is the medial turbinate, this is the inferior turbinate, and this is the quana, this is the posterior quana. So what is happening out here is mass coming out of the medial meatus. So you have to differentiate whether it is a polyp, whether it is a rhinosporidiosis or some granulomatous diseases, so, or a malignancy. So in this case, it was a inverted papilloma, which grows inside, and it behaves like a malignant mass. It destroys the bony structure of the lateral wall of the nose, and may erode the other surrounding areas, and gives rise to epistaxis and other symptoms. Now, first we'll see antrogonal polyp. Now, they have a different parts. This antrogonal polyp have three parts. One is your antral part, which is your maxillary sinus. Next is your nasal part and a choanal part. Out of these three parts, the biggest part is your choanal part, because the choana is having a room, space is there. So that in that space, the polyp can grow easily and become a globular mass. And it arises from the posterior wall of the maxillary antrum and have a very thin neck that passes through the maxillary sinus ostium, and it comes into the nasal cavity. Usually it is because of infection in the maxillary sinus, and it is unilateral and mostly seen in your children. Microscopically, it is lined by ciliated pseudostratified epithelium that is usually intact with a thin basement membrane. Now, this is the picture of a antrogonal polyp. See, this is the globular part, which is situated in the choana, and this is the stalk. This is the narrow part, this is the ostium part, and this is the flat part that is in the nasal cavity. What are the chief complaints? If you see the chief complaints, you will see the patient will come with unilateral nasal obstruction with thick nasal discharge in that part of the nasal obstructed nasal cavity. The patient may have sometimes headache, and he or she will complain of hyponasality. There will be history of sometimes sneezing. Then you have hyposmia, anosmia, epistaxis, and the patient may have conductive type of hearing loss. Suppose there is a mass in the nasal cavity, it is growing and going back to the choana. So in the choana, what is there? You have the eustachian tube orifice is there, and it get pressed over the eustachian tube orifice and leading to obstruction in the eustachian tube orifice. So leading to your negative pressure in the medial ear, because the medial ear is ventilated through that this orifice, and so the medial ear ventilation is jeopardized and leading to your retraction of the medial ear, retraction of the tympanic membrane, and sometimes there is secretory otitis media leading to your conductive deafness. So these are the or the sequelae of and the complications of your polyp. Now coming to the examination part, what is there? You have on examination, you take a nasal, this is your Thuthicum nasal speculum. You can introduce it in the nasal cavity and you lift up and see the interior of the nasal cavity. What is there? You will see a soft, smooth, grayish, mobile mass is there in the nasal cavity, which is obstructing the whole of the nasal cavity. And there may be, on examination of the oral cavity or the oropharynx, you will see that there is a globular mass is hanging down behind the uvula. This is uvula. This is a globular mass hanging down behind the uvula. So on probe test, you will see that this mass is soft, mobile, insensitive to touch, and the probe can be passed all around the mass and it doesn't bleed. And it doesn't bleed because it is less vascular. What are the investigations? On investigations, X-ray paranasal sinus is going to give you only limited information about the disease, only like your haziness in the maxillary sinus. Haziness, this is actually a CT scan picture, haziness in the maxillary sinus. Whereas the rule is to do a high resolution computerized tomography of paranasal sinus. That is your HRCT of paranasal sinus and a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. So these two forms your basic pillar of your investigation. And after seeing these two, you have to decide whether you want to go for surgery or your goal of your treatment will be your medical treatment. Now, treatment, you have to treat the underlying infection with your antibiotics. Then you have to go for your surgery. Ultimately, you have to remove this polyp by your internasal polypectomy by avulsion technique. That is called avulsion technique. But there is a notorious type of thing in this antagonal polyp. There is high chance of recurrence. If it is said that if there is recurrence after a polyp avulsion of the polyp, you have to do a caldoloc operation. Because without caldoloc operation, you can't reach the interior of the maxillary sinus, which is the bed of the origin of the this antagonal polyp. So you have to remove those diseased mucosa from the maxillary sinus by doing caldoloc operation. This caldoloc operation is what? This is a incision is given over the upper gingivobuccal sulcus and the anterior wall of the and the anterior wall of the maxillary sinus is exposed, and a small opening is created there in the anterior wall of the maxillary sinus, and through that opening you go into the maxillary sinus. Okay, this is caldoloc operation. This is actually done very rarely in this era, because we have a better alternative option, that is your FES. What is FES? FES is your functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Now, in functional endoscopic sinus surgery, there is a difference between functional endoscopic sinus surgery and endoscopic sinus surgery, and that I will cover it in later on. So just remember, FES can be done for removing the antagonal polyp. Now come to our next topic, that is your ethmoidal polyp. Now ethmoidal polyp is not a single polyp. It is multiple polyps taken together like a bunch of grapes. The grapes-like thing, multiple polyps will be there, and it is bilateral. Because ethmoidal cells are multiple in number, and the multiple cells will give rise to multiple polyps in nasal cavity. It mostly occurs in adult, and it is your allergic in origin. So this is allergic in origin. You have to differentiate between these two. Now, what are the symptoms? Symptoms will be almost similar, but there will be bilateral obstruction. In this case, there will be bilateral obstruction. Otherwise, there will be thin nasal discharge, headache, anosmia, hyposmia, sneezing, etc. What will you see on examination? On examination, you will see that there is broadening of the nose. That we call frog face deformity. We called it, the nose is broadened because of the mass in the nasal cavity on the both side. On anterior rhinoscopic examination, there will be bilateral multiple small grayish white mass will be there. So when you examine with anterior rhinoscopic mirror this Thudicum nasal speculum, you see there will be multiple small grayish mass which is pale in color, insensitive to touch. Okay, all the parameters will be same of a polyp. On posterior rhinoscopy, we will not find anything more because it is not growing posteriorly. Probe test, it is soft, mobile, insensitive, and do not bleed on touch. As simple as it is. Now, what are the investigations you will do? You will do a simple paranasal sinus X-ray you can do, where you will see only haziness in the ethmoidal sinus. But you can do also blood test. You will see eosinophil, absolute eosinophil count will be raised. And the nasal secretion, which is secreted in the nasal cavity and it accumulated in the nasal cavity, to take the nasal secretion from the middle meatus area. And then you can make a slide and you examine for the eosinophil count. If it is more than 10 per high power field, then you call it eosinophil dependent this ethmoidal polyp. And the most important is your high resolution computerized tomography of paranasal sinus and a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. By looking at these two, you can plan your treatment. Now, what will be their treatment? Treatment in ethmoidal polyposis, you can give medical treatment or surgical treatment, but mostly we have to give both the treatment, medical as well as surgical treatment. Oral and topical nasal steroid administration is the primary medical treatment. And it is seen that antihistamines, decongestants have very little or limited benefit. Immunotherapy has to be given for your allergic rhinitis. You have to, side by side, you have to treat the allergic rhinitis also. Antibiotic has to be given for your superadded infection. Okay? If there is superadded infection, you have to give broad spectrum antibiotics. Now, topical nasal steroids. This is the main treatment of your ethmoidal polyp. Now, I tell you, I have a limited time of another 10 minutes. So, if I log out, then you can again join again. Okay? So that we can continue our class. You have to rejoin again, okay? So topical nasal steroid, it is your beclomethasone, silisonide, flunisolide, fluticasone, propionate, fluticasone furate, mometasone furate, triamcinolone acetate. These are the different molecules of nasal steroid spray available. Out of this, we mostly use this fluticasone, propionate, or furate, or mometasone. These are very helpful in reducing the inflammatory load in the nose and paranasal sinus mucosa. This decreases the size of the shrink, the size of the nasal polyp, decreases the congestion in the nasal cavity. So it helps in a multifactorial way. It reduces the rhinitis symptom. It reduces the loss of sense of smell. Then it prevents the recurrence of the polyp after operation. So this is the way you give nasal spray in the nasal cavity, and it has to be given for long term. You have systemic corticosteroids. We can give also systemic corticosteroids like your oral prednisolone, 1 milligram per kg per day for 10 to 14 days, and then we can taper it. We have depot type of injection, that is 100 milligram prednisolone can be given. And these oral corticosteroids than this topical nasal spray, steroid nasal spray, reduces the symptoms of nasal polyp, like your obstruction, anosmia, then it decreases the nasal this size of the nasal polyp. So we call it medical polypectomy. What are the risks? You know, there are certain risks of steroids, oral steroids. So the risks are your insomnia, personality changes, there will be obesity, there will be weight gain, glaucoma, cataract, osteoporosis, if it is given more than 3 months of use, peptic ulcer may be there, then there may be bleeding from the this ulcer leading to your hematemesis melina. So we have to be very much cautious during giving this systemic steroid. But the steroid nasal spray is safe for your long-term use. Now, what are the surgeries we can do for ethmoidal polyp? One is your full house face, that is your endoscopic sinus surgery, where you remove all the disease tissues, leaving the normal anatomy of the nasal cavity and the paranasal sinus, and you open up all the sinus ostium, like your maxillary sinus ostium, the frontal sinus ostium, ethmoidis, partitions of the ethmoid is completely removed. Sphenoid is sphenoid is completely opened up. So this is called full house face or endoscopic sinus surgery. Whereas we can do face in limited diseases, you can do face. The face is your functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Here, very limited type of surgery is done, where you have removal of the uncinate, then you can remove the you can widen the middle meatus, ostiums, like maxillary sinus ostium is connected with your to the accessory ostium. So in this way you can do the surgeries for your ethmoidal sinus, and you can remove the ethmoidal polyp. And after that, you have to do some certain things. You have to follow up the patient. You have to routine checkup of this patient on a long term, and you have to advise the patient to continue the medical treatment after the surgery, so that once you have opened all the sinuses, then you have to advise the patient to wash the nasal cavity with the saline nasal wash and to give topical nasal steroid spray on a long term basis, and on monthly basis or fortnightly week basis, you can examine the nasal cavity for is there any recurrence of the disease. And if there is any recurrence, you can increase the dose of the steroid, and you can give pulsed oral corticosteroid. So in the post-operative management, you have to examine the nasal cavity with nasal endoscopy. You have to give topical nasal steroid for a long-term basis, and you can give pulsed corticosteroid on a demanding basis. So if there is any recurrence of the nasal polyp, small recurrence, you can give oral corticosteroid for a shorter period of time to avoid the unnecessary side effect of your oral corticosteroids. So this was all about your nasal polyp, and I have 3 minutes more. Supriya, can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir.
So,
hello.
I can show you some slides of this. This is your uncinectomy. Can you see? This is the medial turbinate, and this is the uncinate, and this is the septum. So, when you can do it with a sickle knife, can be taken, and you can incise it. This is called uncinectomy. And once the uncinectomy is done, this you can see the
major. Sir, screen is not visible.
It's not visible. Okay, just
no,
a minute.
Sir.
Just. Okay, do one thing. I'm stopping my screen share. Where is my screen share? Just a minute. Is it visible now? Is it visible? Hello?
No, sir.
Okay.
Hello?
Hello? You people.
Hello, sir.
Hello. You people, now the time is only 1 minute remaining. So just do one thing, you people. Just close down and again you rejoin. Okay.
Okay, sir.